building societies I'm familiar with. My father, we bought the first house when I was a kid with the Bristol and Welsh Building Society. And they came into existence because banks wouldn't loan people money who needed it. They'd only loan it to you if you didn't need it. So people got together, put their money into a kitty, waited their time, and then bought a house. My first job was in Weston-super-Mare with a cooperative society back in 1971. And then more recently, I've had involvement where I live in Mullaney, Queensland, with the co-ops there. Most of those started by Jill Jordan. Interestingly, when I was with the co-op, you actually had a ledger. Everything was put into a ledger. They made the mistake of giving you stamps because Greenshield stamps did that back then in those old days. But of course, by giving out stamps, it meant they were no different from anyone else. They were just giving discounts. So they lost that connection with membership. I'm going to touch on here. If you haven't had a look at mutual value measurement, it's really well worth looking at it. It's a way I see this as a good, like a value balance scorecard, which you can then very useful for organization, getting a sense of values where things are working. A lot of work's gone into this in terms of starting to measure value. What I'm going to be talking about today is the ability to capture value. That's the start point. If you can't capture value, you can't use the value you've generated for an intended purpose, all right? And if you can't do that, then you're limiting yourself dramatically. From the point of view of technology, I want to explain how that's going to impact on new mutuals. So if we go back to 94, I put this article together with a friend of mine, John May, a brilliant writer. And basically all we were saying back then is that no one really knew much about the internet back then, but three technologies would bring about the internet, which of course it has. Back in 2000, Silicon Valley, we suggested that three legal instruments, we said the next big change isn't going to be technological. The next big change is going to be when you can put legal and financial instruments in that technology, where embedded into the DNA and the internet. We gave the example, just three of those instruments, promissorial notes, common law, and bona fides. Those alone would allow for the first time to aggregate the demand for the first time in human history. And match that with supply, okay? And that's huge, the implications of that. And we are there today, just beginning. But it's taken 20 years, so come on, technologists. Come on, get coding. 20 years. Okay, so here we are today. We've got new technologies which allow us to start to do that, blockchain, coming up next year, holochain. Those kind of instruments will then find themselves into Web 3, Web 4. So the neural network will just do that. And of course, it's add some quantum into that over the next 8 years, and we're cooking with gas, okay? But it means that to create something new, to add a new capability into this interconnected environment, the skill sets are really important to understand. It's a bedrock of technology, but it's not technologists who write that strategy, who determine the architecture as it has been in the past. That's going to be a mixture. It's value, so not just money. I mean human generated captured value. Things like trust, okay? Things like kindness, where those things are mechanized within that digital world. And they're not just become currencies, but actually then become assets. And eventually, my calculation is that the money as we understand money is stuff you can use, 80% of that will be underpinned through human-generated value. So the byproduct of that is more human value, as opposed to today, the byproduct is compound interest. So for me, it's not the people who own the money. There is enough, if you do all of this, to get equity going in terms of money, but there's not enough money to pay for the debt. It's the compound, it's the compound debt that you have to look for. Anyway, so if you have that finite, that value, the consensus governance, as we used to call it, but it's not just top-down centralized government, but it's also what I'm calling tribal, you know, peer-to-peer. It's in that consent of pulling that together. It's more of a consensus model, and then understanding relationships. You need those three skill sets to be able to look at how we're going to, if you're going to automate everything and allow interaction with that, you need to understand it's those three qualities that will pull together the full ontology. And so how do you go about, you know, even determining what the probability is of value being occurred, and then what the implications of that would be by introducing something new. And the methodology I teach at Holt and have used myself is, you know, is by determining, you know, firstly the root cause problems, so getting people to not just chase problems, identify the cause or the group root cause, and then all the cascading day-to-day pain, figure that out, and then looking at the measurable value, both in terms of monetary value, but more importantly, and most of the value in day-to-day activities and in business is not monetary. Most of it, in terms of what makes the world go around when you analyze it, okay, are other currencies. But we ignore those because we don't know how to deal with those. So we bring everything back to a monetary value and then translate it back. That's where all the waste and friction occurs. But I think what I'm introducing is the notion of alchemy, digital alchemy, where the sum total of that value is greater than all the component parts. Sounds weird, but that's when you start capturing human value and you can put that in. So for example, if you've got a syndicate of 1 million people who've given you, just with those instruments, their legal power of attorney to purchase on their behalf, then what would be the commercial value of that syndicate and what would be the beneficial value of all that activity? Okay, and this work I've done for people like Toyota would suggest that if we start to, as the technology is coming into play over the next year, to be able to do this aggregation, you know, the work I've done for people like Toyota means that none of us within the next 5, probably 6 years would necessarily buy a car retail, if by then you're buying cars, of course, because you'll be able to buy it as an aggregated group. And why would you do that? Because you get the same price as Avis. And what's that? 50% off markup price. Of course, by then you'll be sharing, but you'll be sharing as an aggregated group. Okay. And so once you start looking at those value calculations, it gets really cool. Okay, but the trick is to then, out of all the value you can generate, how much of that can be captured and then applied? Because if you can't do that, you can't get that figure of eight coming back to and drive that value back down to the grassroots. It's all going to end up in someone's pocket, you know, all four people on the planet who own everything. So that's, and through that, I put three buckets, you know, optimization, pretty straightforward, the value, doing stuff innovative and new, and then this digital alchemy. So looking at projects like, it was great earlier this morning with Findhorn. That was when I was young, that was the, you know, the place to visit. And I'm working with a group in Crystal Waters, just to give you a sense. What we do is we start looking not just at the problems we know about, but we do a mapping of all of the trends, mega trends, financial drivers, social drivers, on the people or the sector, in this case with Crystal Waters, and we're going to be inviting everyone here. I've put Sabine's email on here. We're going to create a wiki to start. We're starting to do some work on mapping. Where is the space going? So if you look at the members, forget about the organizations, cooperative, mutual membership, people behaving, collaborative behavior, sharing space, the new distributed space. What impact? And so we mapped out all of these tipping points, and we just started. This is our first draft. You can see it's work in progress. I just grabbed it from the file this morning. It's probably full of spelling mistakes because I've did it. But the red line there is looking at the natural pathway if we do nothing on terms of mass globally mass membership. So you've got the first tipping point is when the sentiment of anxiety reaches such a negative impact that it starts having an impact on political agendas, social and markets, okay? That sentiment. And if nothing happens, it drops down to some pretty ugly places. But if you intervene, and what all that's necessary, that I was really surprised when we looked at it, is it's a narrative. And that narrative is that it's a believable narrative that actually it's possible. Just by seeing that something is possible, it becomes possible. Isn't that weird? And that possibility is that we could share in all shapes and forms. There's enough. There is enough. If we can find ways without burning the planet, without screwing everything, without, you know, hurting each other, there's enough. And there's ways and means which we can do that. And if so, if the narrative is to show that's possible within a short period of time, it will lift it from that line. What we next see is a big change. One is that we game it. And that was really interesting working with in the blockchain world, because it's predicated on game theory. And the problem with game theory is that I'll only work with you or you if it's something in it for me. But if we can find that there's actually, we have commonality, and if that commonality is to a point where I'll self-sacrifice something for the common good because it's sacred to me, then even though the gaming will have an advantage to begin with, it burns, because then all the point you get disintermediation. But the game, but that other one means that it starts to actually build strength, and it means you can actually aggregate the whole, the sum whole. Anyway, I won't go into that, but anyone interested in that, they want to join in playing this, work with those guys. And here's another example I really want to give quickly. This is a project, been 9 years in the making. It'll be a mutual by the end of the year. And we've gone for a mutual as a specific requirement for its particular its structure. This is Health Commons. It basically it teaches and enables people how to manage their chronic condition in context of their circumstance. But the point is they manage. They can not only manage, but they can capture, they can measure the impact of traditional medicine or mainstream medicine, but also lifestyle changes. And they, through the, this is the, some of the interfaces that we're looking at. It means that we can actually, individuals can verify the value of any combination of resources, including kindness, including the entire mixture that they've used to basically manage their chronic condition and get where they want to get. And they can capture that as intellectual property, and they can own it. So we will give, through smart contracts, through legal agreements, make the intellectual property of the person theirs. So if someone de-identifies that data and sells it, like your GP, they go, that's theft. No different from a car, for the first time anywhere in the world. And that means that individual, and this is how rich the information will be in terms of the different types of correlation to be able to validate that those combination of resources locally, what impact had on the individual. I'm going to be measuring it with Queensland Health. We'll be able to show that if you take that adopt a participatory approach to healthcare, i.e. the individual self-managing, we'll be able to prove how many hospitals you don't have to buy. Now, the ontology of that, you guess the commercial value of that. If we can show that we could put back by 5 or 10 years a new hospital is $2 billion, okay, capex. The opex is somewhere minimum $1,100 US a night per bed. So just in our little region where I live, we need 1,000-bed hospital every 10 years just to keep up with demand, committed for 30 years. Now, if you can show that you don't need one of those, or you could put one of those back by 15 years, that's the commercial value of that ontology owned by the people in the mutual. How's that for assets? All right, get me? Thank you. Yeah, I love this project, okay? And so what we do is, so that's the capture. We can capture what, in this case, this project, what people, we can capture resources, we can capture the value to the economy, to resources, and we can feed that back in so we can make not just knowledge-based decisions, but wise ones. And I can't go into today into the depth of it. I just want to let you know there is a methodology on how we do that. It's not just, you know, ad hoc. That's the top line is the whole methodology. The bottom line is just an example of what I teach at Holt, and we'll have that as an app. This app here, where you can basically start mapping out, doing the calculations on each individual actor, the impact of them, the value impact of them of introducing anything into that environment. Okay, and it solves wicked problems. So on that note, have I just got a few more minutes? Great. Phew. So if we draw back and say, yeah, but so what? You know, so what if you could? All right. And what's excited me for 20 years? It's really cool being old, by the way, for any of you really young, is that you can sort of, you know, you've got bruises and scars, so you know what won't work. But being able to see something evolve over a period of time, you can see things coming. So my prediction is watch the 5-year-olds. So the reason I say teach at whole and teach other, and now putting into an app so we can get it, I just want to give that capability out so we've got hundreds of thousands of young, innovative people creating, understanding how to create value. Because that generation of the 20-year-olds now to the 40-year-olds, after that, you're a little bit old, guys. Luckily, I'm so old that I don't intimidate them. They let me play with them. My students, I don't, you know, I'm not, they're not, there's no competitiveness. I'm just out there. But it's so that they can create the preconditions for the four-year-olds. Because when I do my mapping, every time I do the mapping, I've done a lot of complex mapping. These 4 to 5 year olds are going to bring about a new age of enlightenment as a consequence of being interconnected, of being connected, of the consequence of being able to understand. And think of it more like quantum, that they can actually understand that they can make a change through that desire for that change because they see the capacity. And if we go back to, say, when I suggested that that would happen in the Metro South area with Logan involved on people managing their own health, where, you know, we would look at the prognosis and diagnosis and, you know, it's heading for a foot amputation. Okay, through, you could say, right, well, you're pre-diabetic, but you're heading, and this is when you're going to have, you're going to go blind or you're going to have your foot chopped off. And people would say, they were cold. We're just like, well, that doctor's going to manage it, going to monitor me. It's going to happen. There's nothing I can do about it. And of course, and they were freaking out. It's just like, well, people, they can, but no one believes they can. But it was through them being shown how to do a little bit of research, how to just ask the doctor without really getting them offside, that they could see, firstly, that they were heading there, and that, and, but then they could see the possibility of a lifestyle change, which in many cases cost them nothing, but that possibility arose. And as soon as that kicked in, we had a heat exchange. It got hot, it got desire, and that created currencies and started driving. And it, people, because there's monitoring for 12 months after being taught, and people then got to a point where there wasn't a prognosis of going to the hospital. Okay, and of course you're looking at what are the barriers and inhibitors, and so we'll be able to measure what were the combination of resources which even allowed someone to feel that possibility to, whether they're like, well, I could, but would I? All right, so we can drill right down to individuals, or we can look at whole industries and start to, for the first time, get this holistic sense and start really looking intelligently and saying, okay, well, how do we do this without having huge capital? How can we do it as within our own capacity today? And it doesn't take much. So anyway, that's my story. My narrative is that because of this newfound capacity to not just measure value, but to capture it, drive that back in every way to individuals so that we've got assets. And it's those new assets and it's those new currencies which make the difference between being able to do it or not being able to do it. They change the whole equation.